In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
I want to study with you for a few minutes this evening the subject of joy and happiness. Do you have joy in your heart, and are you really happy? One of the people that I enjoyed knowing, when he's dead now, but when Evelyn and I lived in Texas, when we first moved there, the Union Conference president, name was Ben Leach, Elder Ben Leach. And he used to say, if I was any more happy, I couldn't stand it. And he was a happy person. And if I am really a Christian, I will be one of the happiest people in the world. And if I don't have that happiness, then the next question is, what's the matter with my religion? And my dear friends, there are many Seventh-day Adventists that don't have happiness because they don't have the real thing. And so they're very unhappy. They've left things off from the world, but they haven't acquired anything to take the place of what they've left off. And so they don't have the joy and happiness that they ought to have. And I want to study with you for a few minutes about joy and happiness. Before we get started, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we'll study. Father in heaven, we thank you for Jesus, our Savior. We thank you for what he has provided for us. And we humbly but earnestly pray that you will help us to get a firm understanding of the subject that we're going to study so that we cannot be deceived by the enemy who is deceiving almost a whole Christian world today on these things. So we pray that you'll help us to see clearly the real issues at stake and what the real truth is. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you know why you were created? A lot of people don't know why they were created. I want to read to you a relatively long passage from the book Christ Object Lessons. We could just read a sentence or two, but I think you'll get a lot more out of it if you see the context that shows why were men created, why were women created, why was the human race created. And this passage in Christ Object Lessons starts on page 289. And this is what it says. It's talking about the children of Israel. Through disobedience to God, Adam and Eve had lost Eden, and because of sin, the whole earth was cursed. But if God's people followed his instruction, their land would be restored to fertility and beauty. God himself gave them directions in regard to the culture of the soil, and they were to cooperate with him in its restoration. Thus, the whole land under God's control would become an object lesson of spiritual truth. As in obedience to his natural laws, the earth should produce its treasures, so in obedience to his moral law, the hearts of the people were to reflect the attributes of his character. Even the heathen would recognize the superiority of those who served and worshiped the living God. Behold, said Moses, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me that ye should do so in the land whither ye go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations, which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is there so great who hath God so nigh unto them as the Lord our God is in all things? that we should call upon him for? And what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? That's Deuteronomy 4, 5 to 8. The children of Israel were to occupy all the territory which God appointed them. Those nations that rejected the worship and service of the true God were to be dispossessed. But it was God's purpose that by the revelation of his character through Israel, men should be drawn to him. To all the world, the gospel invitation was to be given. Through the teaching of the sacrificial service, Christ was to be uplifted before the nations, and all who would look unto him should live. All who, like Rahab the Canaanite and Ruth the Moabitess, turned from idolatry to the worship of the true God, were to unite themselves with his chosen people. As the numbers of Israel increased, they were to enlarge their borders until their kingdom should embrace the world. God desired to bring all peoples under his merciful rule. Now notice the next sentences. He desired that the earth should be filled with joy and peace. He created man for happiness, and he longs to fill human hearts with the peace of heaven. Why was man created? For happiness. That's why man was created, was for happiness. That's what it says. And so the framers of the Constitution of the United States were not stupid when they figured out that everybody has a right to engage in the pursuit of happiness. The question is, how can happiness be successfully pursued? That's a question. So God made the human race for happiness. You were created for happiness. That's why God created you, and he wants you to be happy. He created man for happiness, and he longs to fill human hearts with the peace of heaven. He desires that the families below shall be a symbol of the great family above. So, you were created for happiness. God wants you to be happy. If you follow him, you are going to be happy. The religion of Christ produces the greatest joy that human beings can enjoy. And if we do not have happiness, there's something wrong with our religion. We need to find out what's the matter. There's something the matter with our religion if we don't have happiness. Now, that was from Christ's Object Lessons. I want to read you also a statement from Desire of Ages, page 57. This is point number two. Point number one is man was created for happiness. The second thing we're looking at is, where are you going to find the greatest happiness that you can have? Well, here's where. This is a fairly long statement, too, from Desire of Ages 56 and 57. They must fall who would rise again. We must fall upon the rock and be broken before we can be uplifted in Christ. Self must be dethroned. Pride must be humbled. If we would know the glory of the spiritual kingdom. The Jews would not accept the honor that is reached through humiliation. Therefore, they would not receive their Redeemer. He was a sign that was spoken against. In the light of the Savior's life, the hearts of all, even from the Creator to the Prince of Darkness, are revealed. Satan has represented God as selfish and oppressive, as claiming all and giving nothing, as requiring the service of his creatures for his own glory, and making no sacrifice for their good. But the gift of Christ reveals the Father's heart. It testifies that the thoughts of God toward us are thoughts of peace and not of evil. Jeremiah 29:11. It declares that while God's hatred of sin is as strong as death, his love for the sinner is stronger than death. Having undertaken our redemption, he will spare nothing, however dear, which is necessary to the completion of his work. No truth essential to our salvation is withheld. No miracle of mercy is neglected. No divine agency is left unemployed. Favor is heaped upon favor, gift upon gift. The whole treasury of heaven is open to those he seeks to save. Having collected the riches of the universe and laid open the resources of infinite power. He gives them all into the hands of Christ and says, all these are for man. Use these gifts to convince him that there is no love greater than mine in earth or heaven. His greatest happiness will be found in loving me. Until you have a love relationship with your Creator, you will never experience the greatest happiness that you can enjoy. It's an interesting thing, by the way, friends, that even in this world, most people recognize that there is no happiness without love. There's no happiness without love. But your greatest happiness will be the result of having a love relationship with your Creator. And so if you don't have happiness, then one of the first questions to ask is, what is your relationship with your Creator? Now, next, the third point I want you to see is that our Creator is actually the source of joy and happiness. And so if you're not connected with Him, you're not going to have happiness, of course. Look in your Bible. Look in the book of Psalms. Psalm 16. Psalm 16 and verse 11. It says, you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures for how long? Forevermore. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, before they sinned, they knew what the source of their joy and happiness was. Fallen men are very deceived on this point, I have discovered. People think that his joy was in Eve and Eve's joy was in Adam. Well, yes, they were happy to be with each other, but they knew that that was not the source of their happiness. Let me read to you from the book Patriarchs and Prophets. What was their source of happiness? This is Patriarchs and Prophets, page 66. It says, the sacrifice demanded by their transgression revealed to Adam and Eve the sacred character of the law of God, and they saw as they had never seen before the guilt of sin and its dire results. In their remorse and anguish, they pleaded that the penalty might not fall upon him whose love had been the source of all their joy. Rather, let it descend upon them and their posterity. Who did Adam and Eve know was the source of all their joy? It was the Lord, the person that we call today Jesus Christ. They knew that. They knew that He was the source of all their joy. The devil found that out the hard way, too. If you want to read about this, we're not going to go over this tonight, but if you want to read about this, if you have the book Confrontation, read it in that book about what happened to Satan and his angels when they were cast out of heaven. And Ellen White explains how that Satan found out that being in charge of the angels outside of heaven was completely different than being in charge of the angels inside of heaven. And he found out that all of his joy was gone. And the angels didn't have joy either. They were just having contention and bitterness and infighting among themselves. They had no joy. They found out the hard way what the real source of joy is. And one of the things that's happening in this world is the people in this world are empty when they ever think about it. And so to keep them from finding the true source of joy, the devil keeps them totally occupied with going to movies and the sports and things that are just keep them wound up. And then of course some can get a little relief from their emptiness by going to the bottle and getting drunk so that they forget their troubles for a while. But it's all the same game. The people are actually empty. They're not really happy, and they're trying to fill the emptiness with excitement. Let me tell you something. Being excited is not the same thing as being happy. I had a friend in Southern California. I was a pilot. He was a pilot. And one time we were talking about flying in his house, and he says, flying an airplane is hours of boredom mingled with moments of terror. I knew exactly what he's talking about. I know what it is to be so excited. You could never be more excited. But being excited is not the same as being happy. You know, I was in Wisconsin several years ago, and we went to this place, and they call it bungee jumping. And anyway, you get in this contraption, you sit in it, and they have the bungee cords on that, and it goes out to poles. And then after you sit in it, and it's tight and it's anchored to the ground, then they raise the poles so it stretches the bungee cords really tight, and then they let loose. And you ought to hear the people scream when that thing just flies up about 100 feet in the air, and then it free falls, and you think you're going to hit the ground, but of course the bungee cords catch you before you do, and the people are just screaming. And let me tell you, they are excited. And I looked at that and says, a friend of mine, he says, why don't you get on it? I says, you know, I'm happy enough. I don't need that kind of excitement to be happy. But people of this world, there's races or wrestling or boxing or football or movies or something to get you excited so that you'll be happy. But actually, they're not happy. They're empty on the inside. Now, to really be happy, you need to know the source of happiness, and you need to know something about heaven. Now, before we get into this subject at all, I need to define heaven for you. A lot of people think that heaven is a place up, you know, Seventh-day Adventists say, oh, it's a place up there beyond Orion. Well, I'm not contradicting that at all. But that's really not the definition of what heaven is. Let me define heaven for you a different way. Heaven is wherever Jesus is. That's what heaven is. Are you aware of the fact that it says in the book Ministry of Healing, page 18, that when Jesus was here on earth, she says it was heaven to be in his presence? And the reason that place up there is heaven is because that's where Jesus is. Heaven is where Jesus is. And before the disciples knew Jesus, they thought of heaven as a place somewhere up in the sky, and a place where there were spirits. I remember the story of a man that was my pastor many years ago when I was a child told me about an experience he had in Europe. And there was a Seventh-day Adventist family there, and they said, we want you to talk to our daughter. She has no interest in religion. We want you to talk to her. He said, okay, I'll talk to her. So he was talking to her, and she told him that she had no interest in religion. And he asked her about heaven, and she said, well, you know, I'm not interested in going to heaven. Heaven is a place, they tell me, that there's angels that play harps, and I don't care for harp music. And there's people that sit on clouds, and I'm not interested in sitting on a cloud. And when she got done, he thought, well, you have no idea what heaven is. And that's the problem that many people have. There was a lady who was a registered nurse. She was a superintendent of nurses in my father's nursing home, and my mother was talking to her one time. And she actually professed to be a Protestant. And she said, well, if there is a place called heaven, I'd like to go there. And I thought, well, if you want to go to a place like that, are you getting ready to go? So there's a lot of people today that have very fuzzy ideas about heaven, and the disciples had fuzzy ideas about heaven. I want to read to you what Ellen White says happened to the disciples after Jesus came. This was after Jesus ascended to heaven. She says, what a source of joy to the disciples to know that they had such a friend in heaven to plead in their behalf. Through the visible ascension of Christ, all their views and contemplation of heaven are changed. Their minds had formerly dwelt upon it as a region of unlimited space, tenanted by spirits without substance. Now, heaven was connected with the thought of Jesus, whom they had loved and reverenced, above all others with whom they had conversed and journeyed, whom they had handled, even in his resurrected body, who had spoken hope and comfort to their hearts, and who, while the words were upon his lips, had been taken up before their eyes, the tones of his voice coming back to them as the cloudy chariot of angels received him, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Heaven could no longer appear to them as an indefinite, incomprehensible space filled with intangible spirits. They now looked upon it as their future home. Is heaven your future home? Where mansions were being prepared for them by their loving Redeemer. Prayer was clothed with a new interest, since it was a communion with their Savior, with new and thrilling emotions and a firm confidence that their prayer would be answered. They gathered in the upper chamber to offer their petitions and to claim the promise of the Savior who had said, "Ask and you will receive." Heaven was real. Because Jesus was real and Jesus is there. So these disciples had some good news. The word gospel means good news. That's where the real meaning of that word gospel. They had good news to proclaim. And what was the gospel? What was the good news that they had to preach? It was Jesus. They were talking all the time about Jesus. So much were they talking about him that finally the people said, "Those people are Christians. They're just talking about Christ all the time. They're talking about Jesus Christ all the time." And so they began to call them Christians in Antioch. What did they preach about? They preached about Christ in human form, that he was a man of sorrows. They told about his humiliation. They told how he had been taken by wicked hands and crucified. They told how he had resurrected. They told how they had seen him ascend into heaven. They said that he was up there in the presence of God to be man's advocate. And they said he's going to come again with power and great glory, and he's going to take his people out of this world and take them to the same place where he's preparing a place for them. And the news that they preached, the gospel that they preached, turned the world upside down. The world has never been the same since that time. It has been estimated by historians that by 100 AD, somewhere between 5 and 10% of the Roman Empire professed to be Christians. The disciples understood now what Adam and Eve had understood at the beginning. They understood who the real source of joy and happiness is. My dear friends, the reason there's so many people unhappy today because they don't know what the source of happiness is. They don't know who the source of happiness is, and they're not connected with Him, and that's why they're not happy. The Bible describes Jesus, you can find this in Song of Solomon chapter 5, as the chiefest among 10,000, and as the person who is altogether lovely. As I have read many times the account of his life in the Bible and in books like Desire of Ages, I am convinced that the Bible testimony is true. He really is the chiefest among 10,000. He really is the one that's altogether lovely. He really is the source of all true pleasure and satisfaction. He's the giver of every good and perfect gift. The Bible says that God is the giver of every good and perfect gift. He's the author of every blessing. And He's the one in whom our hopes of eternal life are centered. He's the one that can restore to you a cure, a remedy for all the effects of sin. Not only do people have a fuzzy idea today about their Lord and Savior, but they also have a very indistinct and diluted idea about God the Father. And I would like to talk about God the Father for a few minutes. I would like to read to you what Ellen White wrote in 1908 about people's conception of God and how false it is. Here's what she wrote. Many conceive of the Christian's God as a being whose attribute is stern justice, one who is a severe judge, a harsh, exacting creditor. The creditor has been pictured as a being who is watching with jealous eye to discern the errors and mistakes of men, that he may visit judgment upon them. In the minds of thousands, love and sympathy and tenderness are associated with the character of Christ, while God is regarded as the lawgiver, inflexible, arbitrary, devoid of sympathy for the beings he has made. Never was there a greater error. Nature and revelation alike testify of God's love. It is from Him that we receive every good gift. He is the source of life, of wisdom, and of joy. It is the transgression of God's law that has brought woe and death. God made man perfect and holy and happy, and the fair earth as it came from the Creator's hand bore no blight of decay nor shadow of the curse. God cursed the ground for a man's sake. The trials that make his life one of toil and care were appointed for his good as a part of the training needful in God's plan for his uplifting from the ruin and degradation. Well, so first of all, people have a fuzzy idea of Jesus Christ, who He is. He's not real to them. And second, they have a completely diluted idea of the character of God that the devil has implanted in people's minds and put his own attributes upon God. And so people are mixed up about who God is and who the devil is. They think the devil is their benefactor because the devil will tell you that you can do whatever you please. But there is a way to have greater joy in your life than anything that the devil can give you. And I want to go into that right now. How can you get the greatest joy that is possible for a human being to have? It's astonishing to me that there are so few Christians that have a clear understanding of this. I want to read to you something that Ellen White wrote. It's in the Review and Herald, December 6, 1887. It's also in the Home Missionary in 1891. About how a person can experience the greatest joy. Here's the way it happens. She wrote, "Whoever succors the poor or sympathizes with the afflicted and oppressed or befriends the orphan is brought into closer relationship with a pitying Savior. He who is the source of all blessing has granted to men the privilege of becoming partakers of the divine nature and in their turn of diffusing blessings to their fellow men. This is the highest honor, the greatest joy which it is possible for God to bestow upon men." How can you get the greatest joy? It's when your life becomes involved and centered in helping and blessing somebody else. Until you're experiencing that, you're never going to experience the joy that you could have, the greatest joy and honor that God could give you. Now, if you don't ever have that experience, here's what will happen. She says, "Those who thus become participants in labors of love are brought nearest to their Redeemer. He who refuses to become a laborer together with God, the man who for the sake of selfish indulgence ignores the wants of his fellow men, is withholding from himself the richest blessings that God could give him." If you are not involved in doing something to be a blessing to your fellow men, well then, you're not experiencing the greatest joy that God wants you to have and has provided for you to have. I want to talk for a few minutes about satisfaction. I meet many, many people, I'm sure you do too, who are dissatisfied. They're dissatisfied. Did you know that if there had never been sin, there would never, ever have been a person in this world who is dissatisfied? all dissatisfaction and unhappiness as a result of sin. Before sin entered the world, there was no unhappiness in the Garden of Eden. By the way, do you know what the name Garden of Eden means? Do you know what the word Eden, if you ever looked up the Hebrew there, do you know what that means? If we were to translate it literally, it means the Garden of Delight, the Garden of Bliss. There was constant joy, constant happiness. As a result of sin, we have all these problems and things that we have to deal with today. But even after sin, God wanted to show His people that if they would follow Him, they would have satisfaction. I want to read this. I've meditated on this statement many, many times. I started thinking about this when I was a teenager. This statement in the book Education, page 41, has been a great blessing in my life. I pray over it. I say, Lord, this is what You promised. You promised this for me. You promised this to my children. You promised this to every Christian. I'm trusting that You're going to fulfill it. I don't know how You're going to do it. But notice what the Lord wants to do in your life. She wrote, in the arrangements for the education of the chosen people, it is made manifest that a life centered in God is a life of completeness. Every want He has implanted, He provides to satisfy. Every faculty imparted, He seeks to develop. By the way, because of sin, sometimes in this world, there are individuals that it looks to us like they never get satisfaction or happiness or something in this world because of some terrible thing of disease or some terrible problem of sin that they're enduring. Let me tell you something quickly. Anything in this world, if you follow Jesus Christ and you follow Him, anything in this world that because of sin you have lost. Let me give you a quick illustration. I had an aunt. I never met her. She died before I was born. She was born in 1906. She was my grandmother's oldest daughter. The oldest son, who was 4 years older than she, told me in 1987, he said, she was the cream of our family. She was dating a man whose father was a leading Adventist minister. 35 years after she died, when I met that man, who was the president at that time of Walla Walla College, I hadn't been in his office more than a minute or two, and he was talking about my aunt, who he had been courting before she died. 35 years later, that's interesting to me. First thing he starts talking about, just instantly. They would have been married another year or two, but all of a sudden, in 1926, when she was 20 years of age, she developed appendicitis. They didn't have any antibiotics in those days. Her appendix ruptured, and she died. And she said over and over, she said, I don't want to die. But sometimes in this world, you do lose things. But let me tell you something. Let me read it to you from the Bible. Look in your Bible in Matthew 19. Verse 29. Everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive what? 100-fold and inherit eternal life. You're going to receive 100-fold, but from the Lord for anything that you have lost in this world. God wants so much for you to be satisfied that even if you lost something in this world, in the next world, He's going to make it up to you. You're going to get 100-fold for whatever you've lost plus eternal life. And for many years I've said to the Lord, Lord, I don't know how You can do these things. All I know is, when You give to my aunt in the resurrection the 100-fold, I want to be there. I want to be there and see her get it. I don't know how the Lord's going to do those things. But when the Lord gives my aunt her 100-fold for what she lost, I want to see that. So don't think that God can't do what he says he's going to do. If God says, if you follow me, if you want to read it in the spirit of prophecy, look in the book Christologic Lessons about page 179, 180, right in there. And she says, for anything that God's children have lost in this world, including their temporal life, they are amply recompensed. They get a recompense plus eternal life. Let me tell you, friends, the God that we serve is a wonderful God. If you get to know him, you'll love him. And the reason that people are sad is because they don't know Jesus. They don't know the Father. That's why they're sad. Let me read that to you. The life in which the fear of the Lord is cherished will not be a life of sadness and gloom. It is the absence of Christ that makes the countenance sad and the life a pilgrimage of sighs. Here's another one. When the light of heaven shines upon the human agent, his countenance will express the joy of the Lord within. It is the absence of Christ from the soul that makes people sad and of a doubtful mind. Jesus wants to fill your heart with joy. Jesus told his disciples one time, he says, now I'm going to be going. This is just before he's crucified. He says, I'm going to be going and you're going to be really sorrowful. But he says, I'm going to see you again. And your heart's going to rejoice. And your joy nobody is going to take from you. The Lord wants to give you joy, friends, that nobody can take from you. And remember, the greatest joy and happiness that an individual can have, that a human being can have, is if they have a love relationship with their Creator. God wants you to be happy. And one of the wonderful things about human beings is that in our mind we have an imagination, and so we imagine things that are going to happen to us in the future. For instance, children. I've learned this. I've watched children that are 4 or 5 years old talk about, they understand that it's happiness to get married. So they talk about when they're going to get married. I've talked to, you probably have too, you've met 4 or 5 year old children, and they're telling you who they think they're going to marry. Now, they don't know what they're talking about, and 5 years, 10 years later, they'll know that's not the case, but they have figured out that when you get married, that's a time of happiness. So they're looking forward to something that they plan to enjoy in the future. Let me tell you something. I'm looking forward to something that I'm going to enjoy in the future in a place called heaven. And even though there's troubles that we go through in this world, I get great joy in thinking about the future happiness that God has planned for you and me. God has great plans for your happiness. Let me just review a few things quickly that God wants you to enjoy. Now, maybe I'm not a musician, but there are some people here, maybe that you're musicians, much more musicians than I am. There are some people that think that the greatest joy that they can have is music, and that's fine. There's a lot of music in heaven. Let me read to you what God has in mind for you to enjoy in the future. Look in your Bible in Isaiah 35. Verse 10. It says, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing, with everlasting joy on their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall what? Flee away. You realize that there's coming a time when it says sorrow and sighing will flee away. They'll be gone. You will never, ever experience any sigh or sorrow or disappointment or grief. Ever. Never. I've tried to imagine that in my mind, and there is so much sorrow and grief in this world that frankly, it's very difficult for me to imagine, but it's what the Bible says. They're going to have everlasting joy upon their heads, and sorrow and sighing are going to flee away. Heaven is a place of great joy. Here's a few facts about heaven. Number one, the Bible says in Isaiah 65 that they will build houses and plant vineyards. They will not build another inhabit or plant another eat. Mine elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. There's going to be projects people are going to involve in, and they're going to get pleasure from that. Number two, there we shall know even as also we are known. That's 1 Corinthians 13. The loves and sympathies that God has planted in the soul will find truest and sweetest exercise. Number three, Jesus is there. Remember, heaven is where Jesus is. And when you are with Him, you're in heaven. See, heaven is not so much a place. Heaven is where Jesus is. I have too much here to read, but I want to read to you a statement from the book Education, page 309. In our life here, earthly, sin-restricted though it is, the greatest joy and the highest education are in service. And in the future state, untrammeled by the limitations of sinful humanity, it is in service that our greatest joy and our highest education will be found. Now think that through. Our greatest joy and highest education in heaven will be what? In service. If that's going to be my greatest joy and education there, if I'm getting ready to go in that place, what do I need to be doing here? My greatest joy here will be in service to God and my fellow men. I want to close our study this evening by studying for just a very few minutes about the family. Because you pray for me that I won't say it too strong. The primary place where you and I, either preparing for heaven or someplace else, the other place, is in our homes. And I'm very, very sad to see that there are so many homes that are sad, not happy. And when I look at this, I say, Lord, what is this? What's going on here? Are all of these people in these sad homes going to heaven? And the answer is no, not unless there's some kind of a change. So I want to spend just a few minutes studying about the home. This is from Review and Herald, April 21, 1891. There must be no angry words spoken in the home. No seeds of coarse common talk sown in your children's hearts, or they will have no confidence in you when you speak in meeting. God help us to have the peace of Christ in our hearts, that we may teach our children the way of life and peace. We may have a little heaven to go to heaven in if Christ breathes upon us His Holy Spirit. If we receive the Holy Spirit in our homes, what's going to happen in our homes? Our homes will be a little heaven to go to heaven in. Now let's think this through. She says, if Christ breathes upon us the Holy Spirit, our homes will become a little heaven to go to heaven in. Okay, now let's think this through. If my home is more like purgatory, by the way, they don't have purgatory in heaven. If my home is like purgatory and not like heaven, let's think this through. is everybody in my home going to heaven? No. Not if it's like purgatory. They don't have purgatory in heaven. If Christ breathes the Holy Spirit upon us, he says our homes will become a little heaven to go to heaven in. Well, how can that happen? Let's study about that. How can our home become like a little heaven? Here's a statement about it. Ellen White wrote in 1902 in manuscript 77. She said, "Parents, make your home a little heaven on earth. You can do this if you so choose. You can make home so pleasant and cheerful that it will be the most attractive place on earth to your children. Let them receive all the blessings of the household. You can so relate yourselves to God that His Spirit will abide in your home. Come close to the bleeding side of the man of Calvary. Those who are partakers with Him in His sufferings will at last be partakers with Him in His glory." It's interesting, in both these statements, Ellen White tells us that when we receive the Holy Spirit, our homes are going to become like a little heaven to go to heaven in. Okay, how can we make that practical? Well, I found a statement in the Review and Herald, June 26, 1886, that I think explains it a little bit to me how this happens. So I want to close with this statement. We must let Christ into our hearts and homes if we would walk in the light. Home should be made all that the name implies. It should be a little heaven upon the earth, a place where the affections are cultivated instead of being studiously repressed. I'll stop right there. That's not the end of the statement, but pray for me that I won't hurt somebody, but I want to talk plainly. In heaven, the angels love each other. Does that make sense to you? The angels love each other. They work together. They have companions. And their love for each other is freely, openly, and I'm not going to say constantly, but often expressed. And my dear friends, there are many so-called Christian homes today where love and affection is not freely, openly, and often expressed. And we claim that we're getting ready to go to up there. That's not the way they live up there. Up there, love and affection and sympathy is freely, often expressed. Somebody says, "Well, I just don't love my wife anymore, or I just don't love my husband anymore." Well, friend, if that's your problem, you don't know Jesus. Jesus will put if you receive the Holy Spirit, the Lord will put love in your heart for the people in your family. If the Lord has not put any love in your heart for the people in your family, you better go to the Lord and ask to be converted, and to receive the Holy Spirit, and to be changed, and to have a new heart. Because if we don't love the people in our family, please don't be offended. If we don't love the people in our family, we're not going to heaven. We're just plain religion. We're just pretending to be Christians. And my dear friends, there are Adventists all over the country who have sad, unhappy homes. And we say that we're getting ready for Jesus to come, and we're going to go. What? If we really receive the Holy Spirit, our homes are going to become a little heaven to go to heaven in, and one of the first things that has to happen for that to be, home has to be a place where affection and sympathy and love are freely, openly, and often expressed. Did you ever hear the story of a man who was so sad when his wife died, and he said, "Oh, I loved her so much, I almost told her so once." And I thought, when I heard that, I said, that man's crazy. He didn't really love his wife. Maybe that's why she died. How is it in your home? How is it in your family? Let me read the rest of this statement to you. Our happiness depends upon this cultivation of love, sympathy, and polite courtesy to one another. What does our happiness depend on? It depends upon this cultivation of love, sympathy, and polite courtesy to one another. If we don't have that, what will happen? Here's what will happen. The reason why there are so many hard-hearted men and women in our world is because true affection has been regarded as weakness and has been discouraged and repressed. The better part of the nature of those of this class was perverted and dwarfed in childhood, and unless rays of divine light can melt away their coldness and hard-hearted selfishness, the happiness of such is buried forever. That's why people aren't happy. There's no love in their home. There's no sympathy. Sometimes there isn't even polite courtesy. And then they wonder why they're not happy. She says that these people, the better part of the nature of this class was perverted and dwarfed in childhood, and unless rays of divine light can melt away their coldness and hard-hearted selfishness, the happiness of such is buried forever. If we would have tender hearts such as Jesus had when he was upon the earth, and sanctified sympathy such as the angels have for sinful mortals, we must cultivate the sympathies of childhood, which are simplicity itself. Then we shall be refined, elevated, and directed by heavenly principles. Is there free, open, and often expression of affection, love, sympathy, with courtesy and politeness in your home, so that your home, do you treat each other with gentleness, so that your home becomes like a little heaven to go to heaven in? That's what the Lord intended. Are you cultivating love, sympathy, and polite courtesy? Friend, if your home is more like purgatory than heaven, then you need to pray that you'll be converted. Pray for the other members in your family that you all be converted. That you'll receive, she says, unless rays of divine light can melt away their coldness and hard-hearted selfishness, the happiness of such is buried forever. And I read that and I said, Lord, I'm not praying just for myself. I'm praying for my church family. I see all around. There's not the happiness that we should have. Our home should be like a little heaven to go to heaven in. We need to pray and say, Lord, please send us some of those rays of divine light, the Holy Spirit, that will change our hearts so that our homes will become happy. You see, if our homes are not happy, that's absolute proof that at least everybody, maybe some, but everybody in our home is not ready to go to heaven. Well, we need to stop. I hope I haven't been hard on you. That's not my intention. But if we're going to solve the problem, we need to know what the problem is, and we need to apply the correct solution. And the correct solution, friends, number one, do you know Jesus? Are you acquainted with Him? And are you trying to copy His character in your home with your loved ones so that your home becomes a happy place? Home should be the happiest place for the husband, for the wife, for the children. And oh, friend, if your home is like purgatory, pray. Say, Lord, please, send us the Holy Spirit. Don't ask the Lord to change your spouse. Say, Lord, change me. The Lord can change your spouse too, but let that be between your spouse and the Lord. Say, Lord, change me so that our home is not like purgatory anymore, so that we can have a little heaven to go to heaven in. If you want to read, we put together many years ago a syllabus on principles of the Christian family. If you need to study these things more in detail, there's lots of Ellen White statements in there. Almost the whole thing is quotations from the Spirit of Prophecy. But the Lord wants you to have a home that is a little heaven to go to heaven in. Let's pray that we'll receive the Holy Spirit so that our lives and our homes can be changed. Father in heaven, We come to you recognizing our desperate need of Jesus. Because, Lord, our homes are not what you want them to be. There are many unhappy homes, unhappy marriages, but even by Seventh-day Adventists all over the country. And, oh, Lord, we cannot solve this problem. We cannot change the homes that have become like purgatory. But, Lord, we pray, you have promised us that if we receive the Holy Spirit, that there's going to be a complete change. And that our homes are not going to be like this anymore. We're not going to treat each other and talk to each other like we have in the past. And, Lord, I pray that you work this miracle in each home where there are people looking and crying out to you for a change, for a conversion, so that our homes might become happy. Our homes might become a reflection of the home in heaven so that we'll be ready to go to heaven. Oh, Lord, work this miracle out in our homes. We know that only you can do it. But we pray, we intercede for the members of our church family and for your people who are struggling and who are living in a home where it is not happy. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will come into our hearts so that there might be a complete change. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayer, for we come to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.